So very good morning to all of you. Guys, this is the recorded session of day 50 in which we are going to cover the relief package which was announced by Prime Minister last week. And here in this session, we are going to discuss three tranches, tranche 3, 4 and 5, which were discussed by Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman on Friday, Saturday and Sunday. That is May 15, 16 and 17. Right, so I hope you have already watched tranche 1 and 2 which we covered on Wednesday, Thursday and Friday, which were announced on Wednesday and Thursday respectively. Right, so if you have not watched those videos, I will suggest you that you go and watch those first so that you know the trend in which the details of this package are discussed. Right, so now moving ahead. So guys, before moving on to the session, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel and don't forget to press the bell icon which is flashing on the screen, as it can help you to stay in touch with us and it can provide you with access to a lot of good content which can help you to prepare for your examinations, right? Okay, so when Prime Minister Modi addressed the nation and made an announcement of a relief package of rupees 20 lakh crore to fight COVID-19, then he also came up with five pillars of Atmanirbhar Bharat. He told that India needs to be self-reliant and India needs to reduce the dependency on other nations, as now in the current situation it is very difficult to establish relationships with other nations and maintain trade. Right, so these five pillars have already been discussed in the tranche 1 video, so if you are not aware of them, you can watch it. Okay, so now we will begin with part 3. So this is the tranche 3rd, which was launched on May 15, Friday, by the Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman. So in this announcement, she discussed various measures for different sectors, in which the focus has been on the micro level, that how to maintain and come up with measures that are going to help these sectors, right? So first of all, we are talking about agriculture, right? To boost farm produce, what measures has government come up with, right? So one thing that she mentioned was that all of these schemes that are there for agriculture, most of the focus is on short-term crop loans, right? So we do not focus on developing the infrastructure for agriculture, but we focus on providing farmers with short-term crop loans so that they can have little amount of money and they can use that money to buy the raw material that they need to produce the crops, right? But simultaneously, focus should be there on providing long-term agriculture infrastructure, on which focus has not been often. So once if you put money into this long-term agriculture infrastructure, it can take the burden off the farmer and can help that farmer in the long run. So there is a financing facility of 1 lakh crore which will be provided by government for funding agriculture infrastructure projects at the farm gate or the aggregation points. So this means the entities which help the farmers in availing the credit, they are going to be points where the farmers can come for help, like primary agriculture cooperative society, farmer producer organizations, agriculture entrepreneurs. So all those people who have the technical expertise to help the farmer with finance or infrastructure related issues, they are going to be at the epicenter of this scheme, right? So impetus for development of such farm gate and aggregation points, as we just discussed, affordable and financially viable for post harvest management infrastructure. So it is not enough only to produce the crops, but how do you manage the crops? This is equally important, right? Because once the crops are produced, if they are not taken care after, they can get destroyed since they are perishable goods. They cannot, if not maintained properly, they cannot stay for long. That is why it is very important to provide farmers with post-harvest management, right? So usually what happens is if the farmer does not have the facilities for post-harvest, after the harvest, or post-harvest, then in order to prevent the goods from going bad, the farmer has to sell these goods at very fast rates without getting a good price for it. Right? To prevent this fire sale of agricultural products, the farmer is going to be provided with such post-harvest management infrastructure, that is connectivity to markets, storage facilities, or transportation facilities. Right? Moving ahead. So, the next major talks about vocal for local with global outreach. Right? So, under this, a scheme will be launched to help 2 lakh micro food enterprises to provide unorganized units with technical upgradation to FSSAI food standards, build brands and marketing. Right, so here government is talking about micro food enterprises, the organizations which are smaller in size, but they are an important part of this agricultural economy. Right, so such organizations are going to be provided some benefits which can be used on their brand building and getting appropriate standards so that those products, their products become competitive with the world products, right? And also expenditure has to be done on their marketing, right? So guys, government here is focusing that with this outbreak of coronavirus and with our lifestyles becoming unhealthy day by day, the demand for healthy products is growing day by day. So the health consciousness among public is growing, right? So to tap this trend of growing health consciousness, India can be a leader here, because India is specialized with such products. India is very famous in world for its products which provide immunity to the human body and also a lot of nutritional value, right? So not only the production of such products, but we can also focus on boosting exports of such products to global markets who have a huge demand for such products. So there will be tapping of new export markets, right? And it is very important to build brands and spend on marketing of such products so that they can be visible in eyes of their potential customers, right? So here a finance minister focused on cluster based approach. So what does this cluster based approach means? That one area which specializes in the production on one good, that particular area should focus on improving that specialization. Like kesar is very famous, coming from Jammu and Kashmir, mangoes of UP, bamboo in the northeastern parts of the country. Right, so such areas who specialize in certain goods, they have to be provided support so that they can improve their specialization and it can lead to good quality production of products. Right, so this is what cluster based approach is, and also these are certain measures to make the goods more competitive. So I hope you all are familiar with FSSAI, Food Safety and Standards Authority of India. If you're not, you can read it here. So they are responsible for providing adequate rating or adequate standards and seeing that the products which are in the market, they meet these standards, right? So providing such certification from such entities is going to help the goods become more competitive. Now moving on to the next slide. Here we are going to talk about the Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana, right? So here the focus is on fishing related activities. Government is going to launch this scheme for integrated, sustainable and inclusive development of marine and inland fisheries. So marine means sea, water and inland fisheries. Usually it refers to sweet water bodies like rivers and ponds. So a total of 20,000 crore is going to be allocated for this scheme, out of which 11,000 crore are going to be spent on activities for marine inland fisheries and aquaculture. So what are these activities? Activities like cage culture, seaweed farming. So cage culture is a practice where a big cage is put into the sea to catch the fishes, right? And seaweed farming, ornamental fisheries, as well as providing new equipments to the fishermen which can make their task easy, right? So this investment is going to be put into such activities, right? Now here 9,000 crore is going to go for infrastructure like building fishing harbors, providing storage facilities and transportation facilities to these fishermen, building an adequate network which can help them to sell their products into the markets. So efficient markets can be built. So 9,000 crore is going to be spent on infrastructure. So what is aquaculture? Aquaculture means breeding, rearing and harvesting of different types of aquatic organisms or fishes, right? So guys, why are these fishes bred or what is the use of aquaculture? These fishes are a huge source of food in many parts of the country, and also they are used as ornamental fisheries. So if you have ever visited a dentist, you must have noticed an aquarium nearby in the office of that dentist. So these beautiful fishes which are put into that aquarium as an ornament, they help the patients who are suffering from pain calm down, right? So this is ornamental fisheries, I think late. And also there is going to be a ban period support to fishermen. So what is ban period? Ban period is the time is the when the fishermen cannot go for fishing, right? So a fisherman cannot anytime go for fishing. If there are certain climatic conditions which are not permitting this, they are going to be provided with some financial support to support them during the ban period, right? Also, facilities like personal insurance, boat insurance, since fishing is not a very safe task, that is why insurance is provided to them, right? I think rest details, you can read them on your own. Now, moving ahead. So the next slide, it talks about National Animal Disease Control Program, right? So here we have to protect our cattle from getting such certain diseases which can affect their life as well as can have an economic impact on the farmer. So here this program is for controlling FMD, that is the foot and mouth disease, and also brucellosis with a total outlay of 13,343 crore. So here you can see the details of these diseases which usually they affect cattle, but sometimes they can also be found in humans. So that is why it is very important to prevent them so that there is no outbreak or spread of such diseases, right? So this program ensures 100% vaccination of cattle, buffalo, sheep, goat and pig population for foot and mouth diseases and brucellosis. And after that, till date, 1.5 crore cows and buffaloes have been tagged and vaccinated, right? Now, moving ahead to the next slide. Okay, these measures talk about animal husbandry infrastructure development fund. So, I hope we all are clear with the meaning of animal husbandry. Animal husbandry means keeping, rearing of animals for certain uses. So, basically breeding, keeping and breeding of animals, right? So an amount of 15,000 crore is going to be put in a development fund which is going to develop infrastructure for animal husbandry, right? So this is also, so this fund will also provide incentives to be given for establishing plans for exports of niche products. So certain products which have demand only in a particular segment, they are known as niche products. So incentives are to be provided if a producer gets into the production of certain products which can be exported and can earn foreign exchange for the country. So guys, here the government is not only focusing on fulfilling the domestic demand of these agriculture products, but also pushing the export of such products into the global markets. So in the current situation, the world is in need of good quality healthy products which can boost our immunities, right? So we can grab this opportunity if the implementation of these schemes is done right. Also, the milk and milk products produced in India, they also have a huge demand even domestically and even in foreign counterparts, right? So we can tap these new markets and explore them. Okay, now moving on to the promotion of herbal cultivation. So what is herbal cultivation? So cultivation of medicinal plants. So here NMPB, that is National Medicinal Plants Board, has supported 2.25 lakh hectare area under the cultivation of medicinal plants. So guys, you must be knowing that India is a very famous destination for medical tourism. Many patients, even from the Western nations like USA, they come into India. So the treatment quality in US is very good, but there are huge costs incurred, right? So good quality treatment is available in India at low cost. That is why many tourists from Western countries or the Middle Eastern countries where such treatment is not available, all certain poor countries, they come into India for having a good quality medical treatment at low cost. So here we can also talk about the Western medicine or the allopathic medicines, but also our traditional ways of medicine are also popular in the world. So we have to draw emphasis here. So 10 lakh hectare will be covered under herbal cultivation in the next 2 years with an outlay of 4,000 crore, lead to 5,000 crore income generation for farmers, right? So just give me a second. So I hope now we are clear with this. So this point, promotion of herbal cultivation, this is going to benefit the farmer, as well as it is going to give a boost to the export of such medicinal plants, right? As you can see here, 800 hectare area, by developing a corridor of medicinal plants along the banks of Ganga, right? So some area around the banks, along the banks of Ganga, is going to be put in for the cultivation of herbal plants. Now moving ahead. Okay, talking about the beekeeping initiatives. So Prime Minister focused here, Finance Minister focused here, and she told that it is a small area but having huge implications for future. That is why some money is being allocated to these measures, the beekeeping initiatives, right? So as we are aware that bees help us develop products like honey and wax, which have a huge demand all over the world. So it is very important to produce such good quality products. And these bees, they also act as pollinating agents and enhance the quality of crops, right? So throughout the world, there are discussions going on about the reducing population of bees and how it can have a bad impact on the quality of crops produced, right? So we have to give a push to the production of bees. So guys, here you can see how government is trying to develop the natural infrastructure to give a boost to the finance infrastructure, or at least to the micro sections of the societies who live in harmony with such natural environment, right? So here government is going to provide a scheme for infrastructure traceability system development fund related to integrated beekeeping development centers, collection, marketing and storage centers, post harvest in harvest and value addition facilities, right? So this is also going to give a thrust or a push to women, as women are majorly employed in these sectors, right? So if these sectors are developed, they are going to have a positive impact on the income of such women, right? So development of quality nucleus stock. So what is a nucleus stock? A nucleus stock refers to breeding or growing bees in a box or in a small space. As you can see in the picture, there are bees in a box, right? And this will lead to an increase in income for 2 lakh beekeepers and quality honey to the consumers, right? Okay, now moving ahead to the next slide. And this slide says from top to total. So a scheme called Operation Greens will be extended from top to total. So what does this top to total means? Top means tomatoes, onions and potatoes. So earlier the scheme covered only these three products, but now they are going to be, it is going to be extended to all fruits and vegetables. That is why a shift from top to total, right? So scheme's feature will be as follows: 50% subsidy on transportation from surplus to deficient markets, and 50% subsidy on storage including cold storages. So this scheme is going to be tested for a pilot for 6 months as a pilot, and it can be expanded and extended to different sectors as well, right? So guys, here one major concern of farmers is being addressed usually what happens with crops is they are usually perishable goods. You cannot store them for a longer time, at least not without having adequate equipment and facilities, right? So to prevent a distressed sale of such products by farmers so that they do not have to sell their product at a low price or going their hard work into waste when these crops perish, that is why they are going to be provided with post-harvest facilities like storage and transportation so that an efficient network to markets can be created, right? So this is going to lead to a better price realization to farmers, reduced wastages as it aims to prevent the perishing of such goods, and affordability of products for consumers. So how is it going to lead to affordability? Obviously, if there is a good supply, if there is an unhindered supply from the rural areas where the crops are grown to the market, urban markets where there is demand, if the supply is seamless and there are no hindrances, then obviously such supply is going to lead to affordability, right? Here you can have a look about what is Operation Green price fixation scheme that aims to ensure that farmers are given right price for their produce, right? So this scheme is extended from top to total. Moving ahead. Okay, amendments to the Essential Commodities Act. What is the Essential Commodities Act? It is an act which says that if government wants, it can put restrictions on the stock holding limit in case of certain certain circumstances, right? So ECA, enacted way back in 1955, has been used by government to regulate the production, supply and distribution of a whole host of commodities it declares essential in order to make them available to consumers at fair prices. So if there is a demand shortage, if there is demand for a certain product and the supply is not meeting that demand, that so in that case government can put some restrictions on the stock holding capabilities of the producers or different participants of value chain so that they do not hold much stock, they have to release it and sell it to markets, driving the prices down, right? So basic law of demand applicable here. So government now is saying that we are not going to put such restrictions unless and until it is very important to do so, right? So the producer or different participants, the middlemen, they can hold the crops, and if they want, they can also export it or sell it to foreign countries. But if there is an emergency, only then government is going to impose this act so that the goods are not sent to foreign countries and used for domestic consumption and driving prices down in the domestic country, right? So now moving ahead to the next slide. So here you can see some measures which have been taken for developing an efficient marketing and pricing scheme for agriculture. So there are some reforms, as you can see here. Okay, so farmers are usually bound to sell their produce only to licensees and APMCs. What is APMC? Agricultural Produce Market Committee. So Agriculture Produce Market Committee. Just like there is Azadpur Mandi in Delhi, if you are familiar with it. So guys, farmers, so here the government is focusing that the farmers, they have a limited amount of sellers. That is why they cannot drive a good price for their crops, right? So they should not be forced to sell only to a limited amount of buyers, right? Since currently they cannot sell to anyone else who does not have a license in an APMC, right? So here you can see farmers can sell the crops to buyers in other states, as well as infrastructure is going to be developed for online trading of such agriculture products, and so that farmer has a good choice of buyers and can choose to sell their crops at an attractive price, right? So this will ensure risk mitigation for farmers. Farmers will have a certainty that their produce is going to be sold at a good cost, right? Moving ahead to the next slide. So before moving on to the next slide, guys, I would like to ask you to join our Telegram group. On this group, you can ask all your doubts and queries, and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible, right? So the Telegram link is mentioned in the description, and still if you cannot find it, you can mention it in the comments and the marketing team will get to you, right? So moving ahead to the next slide. So here we are going to discuss about part 4, which is launched on May 16. So we are done with the May 15 measures. Now going ahead to part 4, which was launched on May 16, right? So these measures launched on Saturday, they focus on certain sectors and we are going to discuss them here. First of all, talking about the coal mining sector. So government here is focusing more on commercialization of coal, or at least reducing the monopoly of public sector presence in the coal mining sector. So it wants to invite more private players into it, which will introduce competition, transparency and private sector participation in the coal sector. So finance minister said that India is the third largest country having most valuable coal deposits. Then why do we still need to import coal? We have to give a boost to our coal mining sector. So with the entrance of new players into this arena, so competition is going to be improved. That is why efficiency is going to be improved, and probably we can substitute the imports with our domestic production, right? So the revenue sharing mechanism is going to shift from a fixed rupee per ton regime to a revenue sharing mechanism where the losses and the profits can be shared by different stakeholders, right? So earlier only captive consumers with end use ownership could bid. So only those consumers who have some uses for this coal and they are going to use this coal into some other industry, only those can could bid for coal mining. But now this has been opened for different private players, and anyone can bid for a coal block and sell it in the open market, right? Now talking about entry norms, they must, as we just talked about, entry is going to be liberalized and nearly 50 blocks are to be offered immediately, no eligibility conditions, only upfront payment with a ceiling. So only they have to pay a certain amount, and that too a ceiling is going to be put on that amount. Moving on to the next slide. So coal gasification or liquefaction will be incentivized. So turning coal into a gas form or a liquid form is better for the environment, and it helps in, it is easier to store them and transport them in that form. So that is why having a good impact on environment, and it will assist India to switch to a gas based economy, right? So infrastructure development fund of 50,000 crore is going to be launched, and for evacuation of enhanced CIL, that is Coal India Limited's target of 1 billion tons coal production by 2023, plus coal production from private blocks, right? So guys, here you can see how import is going to be substituted. So finance minister focused that we should import lesser and lesser amounts of coal and give a boost to our domestic industry. Includes 18,000 crore worth of investment in the mechanized transfer of conveyor belts from mines to railway siding. So here infrastructure, how transportation of coal from mines to railway sidings where it has to be transported using railway. So this transfer from mines to railway siding can take place with the help of conveyor belts, which would be more safe and it will take less time. So investment for doing such mechanization is up into this scheme, right? Moving ahead, after talking about coal, here we are talking about the mineral sector for giving a boost to the production of different minerals. So India is a country with abundant supplies of minerals, but we need to explore them to their fullest to make an optimum utilization, right? So introduction of a seamless composite exploration cum mining cum production regime. So guys, here the government said it is very difficult for the producers to have different stakeholders. That is why the government is going to provide one scheme where one participant can produce in different stages without any interruption. So 500 mining blocks would be offered through an open and transparent auction process. Introduction of introduction of joint auction of bauxite and coal minerals to enhance aluminium industry's competitiveness, right? And reduction of distinction between captive and non-captive miners to allow transfer of mining leases. So guys, also there is one more thing that Ministry of Mines is in the process of developing a mineral index for different minerals. So this will help in commercialization of minerals and rationalization of stamp duty payable at the time of award of mining leases. So the stamp duty payable by companies, by the bidders, is going to be rationalized. So what does rationalize means? That they this is going to be re-evaluated, and then a check would be made whether it is fine or it needs some changing. Basically putting an appropriate stamp duty which is not a burden on the bidders as well, right? So this is rationalization. Moving ahead to the next sector. The next sector is aviation sector. So aviation sector, as we all know, due to the lockdown, they have suffered the most. Also earlier they were not in very good shape. After the lockdown, since flights have been the airlines are not able to fly, that is why they are not earning any revenue and they are in huge turmoil, right? So only 60% of Indian airspace is available to civil flying. So guys, what does this mean? Whatever space is there in air, like on road, we have land, we have different roads, and certain roads are blocked. And let's say if certain roads are blocked for public, for use by common public, or it is only for use by certain people, like we say Prime Minister of India or President of India. So certain roads are banned for use by normal public, right? So similarly, 60% of the airspace is available for use to normal public. Rest is banned. There is a restriction on that 40% for the use by private airlines, right? So this restriction is going to be eased so that more airspace can be utilized by civilian flying, right? So what would happen by this? If there would be more airspace available, there would be shorter routes available for reaching to destinations that can bring benefit and efficiency to airline sector, right? So it will bring 1,000 crore benefit to aviation sector, and also airports are going to be privatized. And also guys, if more airspace is available and shorter distances are there, that means lesser usage of fuel and lesser cost for the consumers as well. Here you can see there is a thrust on privatization. So in one of our previous lectures, we have discussed that Prime Minister Modi has been pushing to invite bids for privatization of 6 more airports in India, right? So AAI has awarded 3 airports out of 6 for, I think you can read the details on your own. There is not much to talk about it, and we have already discussed in one of our previous sessions the different implications of PPP model in the airport management sector, right? Moving ahead to the next slide. So here India is to become a global hub for MRO. So what is MRO? MRO means maintenance, repair and overhaul. So currently our flights or any equipment related to the aviation sector, if there is a problem in that equipment, it usually has to be sent to foreign countries for repairs. So here government wants to thrust upon developing MRO sector in India so that it will provide employment to our population and also a sector where India can excel in, right? So aircraft component repairs and airframe maintenance to increase from 800 crores to 2,000 crores, and major engine manufacturers in the world set up engine repair facilities in India in coming year. So convergence between defense sector and civil MROs. So all the entities that treat civil MROs, they should be able to treat defense, and all those who treat defense should be able to treat civil MROs as well, right? So government is focusing upon a convergence between these two sectors to create economies of scale, right? So if one entity is going to treat them both, then there is an increase in revenue, that entity can has the benefit of economies of scale. So and if the aircraft components, they are not getting sent to foreign countries, they are getting treated in the home country, the maintenance cost for airlines will definitely come down. Moving ahead to the next slide. So here talking about the measures for defense sector. Just give me a second. Okay. So make in India for self-reliance in the defense production. So whatever weapons or equipments are needed by the defense sector, finance minister said that we should try to import lesser and lesser of it and produce more and more in our country. That can provide employment opportunities to our public, right? So that is what make in India or self-reliance in defense production means. I think you can read these details on your own. So indigenization of imported spares. So the spares or the components, the different raw material which is imported, we should try to produce them in our own country. That is going to improve the autonomy, accountability and efficiency in ordnance supply. So what does ordnance means? Related to defense. By corporatization of ordnance factory board. So the ordnance factory board, it should behave like a corporate. There should be corporatization, not, so guys, don't confuse this term with privatization. Privatization means selling public entity to the private sector, but corporatization means putting the management structure of a corporate into this ordnance factory board, which can make it more efficient, like having board members and having meetings and having audit committees, so that it can be run more efficiently, right? So FDI increased from 49% to 74% in defense manufacturing under the automatic route, right? So I think you can read the rest details by yourself. Here I would like to talk about one point, that is overhauling trial and testing procedures. So whatever equipments are getting made, they have to be tested first, and these testing should take place according to different climatic conditions that are available in India. So overhauling such procedures according to different requirements of different sectors, right? Moving ahead. Now talking about DISCOM's tariff policy reform, right? So government has already provided some benefits for DISCOMs, that is the distribution companies. If you remember, a 90,000 crore liquidity has been provided to them, so that they can meet their dues to GenCos, that are the generation companies, and TransCos, that are the transmission companies, which total to 94,000 crores, right? So one measure which has come up is power departments and utilities in union territories are going to be privatized, right? So this is being done to reduce the burden on government and make the running of such entities more efficient, right? So there is always a norm that the private sector works with more efficiency than the public sector, as the private sector has a profit motive behind it, right? So that is why it is going to be worked on privatization. So certain tariff policy laying out reforms will be released related to consumer rights, that the lag in cost due to DISCOM efficiency should not get transferred to the consumer. The consumer should not pay for the inefficiencies of the DISCOMs, right? And generation and transmission project develops to be selected competitively. So the companies who are generating the electricity and transmitting it to the distribution companies, they should be selected competitively by a proper competitive process, which can help us to find out the best out of the lot, right? So I think you can read the later rest details on your own. Moving ahead to the next slide. Okay, talking about the social infrastructure, government is going to enhance the quantum of viability gap funding up to 30% each of total project cost as viability gap funding by center and statutory bodies. So what does social infrastructure means? Developing hospitals, schools, so basically all that infrastructure that helps us to enhance the quality of life of the public, right? So private sector participation is also being sought into developing the social infrastructure, and viability gap funding, the funding, the gap which exists in the funding, what is required and what is being done. So this funding is this gap is going to be met by government, right? So total outlay is 8100 crores. Moving ahead to the next slide. So it talks about space activities. So Indian private sector will be a co-traveler in India's space sector journey, right? So here the finance minister focused that not only the public sector but private sector should also focus on developing the benefits for space activities, right? So if we have to excel in this field, we have to grab the cooperation of private sector as well in launching satellites, different launches and space-based services. So we'll provide a predictable policy and regulatory environment to private players. So policies, frameworks are being devised for such private players, and they will also be allowed to use ISRO facilities and relevant assets to improve their capacities, right? So they can use the facilities which the ISRO already has. They do not have to develop new facilities for testing their products, right? So more availability of geospatial data for providing remote sensing data to tech entrepreneurs. So all those startup and entrepreneurs working in these sectors, they are going to be provided with data for whatever activities they require. And future projects for planetary exploration, outer space travel to be opened for private sector. So guys, here you can see that in most of the sector, government is trying to reduce the burden on the public sector and include the private sector in the nation building process, right? Moving ahead. Now talking about atomic energy, right? Here government is focusing, giving a push to research reactor in PPP mode. So whatever developments that take in the that take place in the arena of atomic energy, they are going to be in the mode of PPP, that is public-private partnership. We have already discussed this model in our previous sessions. I hope you all are familiar that what is a PPP model, right? For production of medical isotopes which can help in curing cancer and other diseases, establishing facilities to use irradiation technology for food preservation. So food preservation, as we just talked about how important it is for farmers to have proper storage facilities so that their goods do not perish, right? Link India's robust startups ecosystems to nuclear sector. Technology development cum incubation centers will be set up for fostering nuclear energy, right? So focus on nuclear energy as well. So these were the reforms. Now moving ahead. Okay, so guys, we have completed part 4, which were announced on May 16. Now moving ahead to the reforms which were announced on May 17. So first, the finance minister, she talked about the support to MNREGA. Government will allocate an addition of rupees 40,000 crore over and above the budget estimate, right? Budget estimate was 61,000 crore and additional 40,000 crore is going to be pushed in MNREGA scheme, right? Which is going to generate 300 crore more person days of work, and it will be addressing the need of work for returning migrants. So government has provided food facilities for migrants who are doing a reverse migration, moving from urban cities to their rural households as they are scared of this COVID-19 pandemic. So we all must be aware how it is shown in on news channels, the plight of these migrants who are trying to return. They are walking on foot, carrying their luggage, carrying their babies in their hands, on their heads, right? So okay, once if the government provide food for them, but they have to earn when they return to their native places. So this scheme is going to address that need for employment of returning migrants. Moving ahead, talking about the health reforms that finance minister talked about yesterday. So she mentioned how public expenditure on health is going to be increased so that India can be prepared for if any pandemic like COVID-19 comes again in future. That is why we have to invest in grassroots health institutions, so that even people living in remote areas, they have access to good healthcare facilities in rural areas as well as urban areas. So these are the details how India will be prepared for any future pandemics. I think you can read it on your own. Very simple details. Moving ahead. Okay. So, after talking about MNREGA and health sector, Finance Minister emphasized that how there is a push for digital education. So, children, as they are not able to go to schools and attend their classes, so that is why it is not good for them to sitting idle at their home and wasting their time. And also that would have a huge impact on their mental health, as a child needs to be occupied every time, right? So the child needs something to foster for his brain, or providing a food for thought for his or her brain, right? So there is a launch of PME Vidya. So it is a program which will provide online or digital education immediately. So Diksha for school education in states and UTs, e-content, QR coded energized textbooks for all grade, one nation, one digital platform. So Diksha is a digital platform for education. So 1 year mark TV channel per class from 1 to 12, one class, one channel. So one channel that would cover the needs of children or students of one class, right? Extensive use of radio, community radio, podcast, special e-content for visually and hearing impaired students, right? So all those students who have who are specially abled and they have visually and hearing impaired, for them some programs are also to be conducted on radio. And top 100 universities will be permitted to automatically start their online courses by 30th May 2020. That is, from this session, they can begin with the online courses. So if a student is not able to come to the class, that student is going to have educational facilities sitting at home. After that, finance minister talked about an initiative which has been taken for the mental health of students, their families as well as their teachers, which is known as Mano Darpan. So Mano Darpan in Hindi means viewing your heart or analyzing whatever goes in your heart. So this is for the mental health of these students, that they are not so that they do not get any depressed feelings or negative vibes due to this pandemic. And if they are getting such feelings, it can be mitigated, or support can be provided by such initiatives, right? So new national curriculum and pedagogical framework for school, early childhood and teachers will be launched, integrated with global and 21st century skill requirement. And after that, National Foundation Literacy and Numeracy mission for ensuring that every child attain learning levels and outcomes in grade 5 by 2025 will be launched by December 2020. So some more initiatives for the education sector. Moving ahead to the next slide. So in this slide, we are going to talk about the measures which have been taken by the government to enhance ease of doing business in India, so that new startups, new businesses can be promoted in this era, right? So minimum threshold to initiate insolvency proceedings raised from 1 crore from 1 lakh, which largely insulates MSMEs, right? So the limit for initiating an insolvency proceeding, which was earlier 1 lakh, that means if a company makes a default equivalent to 1 lakh or more, the lender can make a request at IBC against that company, right? Or can push IBC, or can at least file a complaint against that defaulting company, so that company can be put into liquidating, right? But now this threshold has been increased to 1 crore. That means if a company is making a default of less than 1 crore, then any insolvency procedure cannot be initiated against them, right? So the threshold is 1 crore or more. Only then insolvency procedures can be initiated. Moving ahead. Special insolvency resolution framework for MSMEs under 240, Section 240A of the code to be notified soon. right? So a special insolvency framework for MSMEs, for small sector industries who do not. So in the first point also, the main beneficiaries are MSMEs, as they are the ones which do not make huge defaults, but still they go into liquidation for this. So a special insolvency framework is going to be made for MSMEs under this section of the IBC Act. And after that, no fresh insolvency procedure would be initiated up to 1 year, depending upon the pandemic situation. So all those companies who are facing financial difficulties or defaulting due to this COVID-19 pandemic, no procedure would be initiated against them. And empowering central governments to exclude COVID-19 related debt from the definition of default. So their default is not going to be categorized as default. So that non-payment by any company due to the COVID-19 related factors is not going to be put into the category of default for the purpose of triggering insolvency proceedings, right? So these are the changes in IBC to help the businesses cope with the COVID-19, right? Moving ahead. So after that, government has decided to decriminalize some of the sections of Companies Act defaults. So all those provisions not following, if company didn't follow all these rules, they had to pay some penalties, or there was a criminal case put up against them. Now most of them have been decriminalized, right? For major technical and procedural defaults, if the company is not doing CSR reporting on timing, or they are not filing board reports or other audit committee reports, not holding meetings. So such technical and operational defaults, they are not going to be put into the category of criminal cases, right? So majority of compoundable offences sections to be shifted to internal adjudication mechanism. So most of the offences, most of the defaults which can be treated by internal measures, they are going to be treated for compounding enhanced, right? 58 sections to be dealt under IAM as compared to 18 earlier, right? So 40 more sections have been added, 40 more offences are added which can be dealt by the internal mechanisms, and there is no need to go to the tribunal for this, right? So this is being done to take the pressure off the criminal codes and NCLT. And here you can see 7 compoundable offences have been altogether dropped, 5 to be dealt under the alternative framework, where leniency has to be shown to these companies. Moving ahead. So now, ease of doing business for corporates. So finance minister announced that direct listing of securities by Indian public companies in permissible foreign jurisdiction. So this is going to help these public companies to raise money from foreign countries as well, and bringing foreign exchange into the country by direct listing of their securities. So direct listing means without holding an IPO, getting your securities, your stock listed on the exchange and raising money from public without having all the formalities of an IPO. So direct listing is cheaper source of fund for the companies, right? And private companies which list their non-convertible debentures on stock exchanges not to be regarded as listed companies. So all those companies who are going to register their debt on stock exchanges, they will not be called as listed companies, right? So there are other provisions as well. I think you can read them on their own. Even the finance minister didn't stress much about or didn't discuss much details about these measures, and they are, I think, simple to understand, and you can read them on your own. Moving ahead. So after that, talking about public sector enterprise policy, this is one policy the finance minister showed light upon. And in this policy, the finance minister said we need a coherent policy where all sectors are open to the private sector. So in the process of nation building, we have to gain the support of private sector, bring them at par with the public sector, right? So instead of closing certain sectors for the private sectors, here what is being done, certain strategic areas will be defined. In those areas, there will be presence of public entities, but not more than 4. So at least one entity is going to be present, one public entity, but not more than 4, and an entry of private players would be allowed, right? So this is the new public sector enterprise policy giving a boost to private sector. After that, the finance minister talked about some aid that they have provided to state government. So I think these are mere financial facts. You can read them on your own. So guys, this was the whole package announced by finance minister on in tranche 3, 4 and 5. Now we have discussed all of them, and if you have any doubts, you can post them in the comments on the video, and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. So thank you for watching this video, and we'll meet tomorrow at the same time with some news, with some set of questions that are going to enhance our understanding of the financial and economic world. So guys, if you learned something new from this video, then don't forget to hit the like button and do subscribe to our channel for latest updates. So thank you and see you tomorrow.